Okay, my article is about manifestations of multiculturalism in Soviet musical aesthetics. Recent non-Russian studies have addressed the formation of Soviet musicology, including ethnomusicology, from the point of view of Soviet nation building. How Soviet musical life was organized in different parts of the country with the help of musicians educated in Moscow and Leningrad conservatories. Recently, Paris, British scholar of Soviet music history and colleague of mine, Neil Edmunds, stated a few years ago that very little is still known about the individuals who worked in or hailed from the Soviet republics, and their music remains comparatively unknown in the West. In my opinion, too little is known about purely musicological work written by the Moscow and Leningrad stereo distance as well. Soviet musicologists are mostly seen in a negative light for what they have stated in the pages of Sovietskaya Muzyka. As Michael Cater has noted about music and Nazism, music and Stalinism too made very bad bedfellows. There are differences in interpretation from one author to another and between authors and editors. According to Cater, the problematic relationship of musicology and nationalism has not been considered in Germany until recently. I hope that musicology has avoided a detailed introspection in this respect also regarding Russia. Different discourses in Soviet science were overlapping and interlinked in a complicated manner. It is indeed very hard to analyze the historical currents of music, musicology and politics side by side and deconstruct how those philosophically different medias were interlinked with each other without making oneself guilty of exaggeration, simplification or polarization. As Michael Rowland has pertinently noted in his study on folk music of Kazakhstan, it is easy to dismiss early Soviet music as kitsch, but in fact, the emergence of new styles and discourse of nation and the reinterpretation of folk traditions provide a rich read for analysis. Rather than dismissing nationality in music for its lack of artistic merit, we should consider it a lens through which to understand the cultural climate of the time and place. My study draws from a notion by Boris Kasparov concerning how one should look at the history of Russian musical aesthetics as a broad and diverse phenomenon, charged with conflicting options and simultaneously developing phenomena that influence each other in harmful ways. My analysis does not conform to a theologically driven transformation, which conforms to the beginning of the century Western modernist belief in progress or the freedom of the world. This is still an acute bone of contention, and often present in a polarized way in the phrasing of questions on the Soviet aesthetic landscape. My paper today deconstructs Soviet multiculturalism in the socialist realist musical aesthetics from the philosophical point of view, as it appears in the literary legacy of the musicologist and composer Boris Asafiev, so-called father of Soviet musicology. Asafiev's literary legacy, I presume, is not challenging only for non-Russian speakers. He's developing theoretical concepts of musical form as a process, which was branded as a socialist realist theory of music in its completed form in 1947, but written in a hermeneutically complex context of cultural transition. The national Slavic rhetoric and terminology that reflect symbolist ideas are most likely obscure also for native Russian speakers. I am currently writing my doctoral thesis about Asafiev's literary legacy at the University of Helsinki as a student of Professor and semiotician Eero Tarasti, who perceives Asafiev's theory foremost as a proto-semiotic theory of music. In my thesis, I am not asking what makes Asafiev peculiarly a Soviet musicologist, or what was his exact historical role in Soviet nation building. Instead, I endeavor to place his theoretical concepts in the history of conventional Western musicological and philosophical canon. My aim is to deconstruct the myth of Soviet musicology as an incomparable other to Western tradition. In the traditional philosophical context, however, Asafiev's literary legacy expanding from 1916 to 1947 becomes also a mirror of early Soviet intellectual culture. It shows how the classical modernist currents continued their existence intermingled with the Soviet state's important traditionalism, nationalism and universalism in the Soviet musical philosophy. Yet Asafiev's aesthetics sustained peculiar freedom of spirit. The important question of my paper is thus, what do Asafiev's writings have to offer us besides the expression of official Soviet nationalism? I first start with his nationalism. Asafiev was a curious choice for the post of an ideological leader of Soviet musicology. He participated devotedly in the nation building of the Soviet Union. Asafiev also mastered the rhetoric of the ruling elite. His sovereign style of writing, utilizing patriotic rhetorical norms, enabled to shape extracts of emotional pathos typical for socialist realism to cultural political views. In 1937, Asafiev stated in his article on Kazakh folk music. There's no time to read all, I just read a bit. Sorry about my accent. Если казахов пленяют своей эмоциональной отзывчивостью, чистотой и ясностью чувства, глубокой выраженной правдивостью, слушая их, испытывая вольную душу, радость соприкосновения с высшей человечностью, мудро выраженной в этих многолитых напевах, прекрасных своей задушевностью и глубоким чудом божественной меры и радости. The excerpt above is taken from one of the articles in the book on Narodnoi music. This collection of articles on folk music was edited during Perestroika in 1987. By reading the collection, it is easy to denounce Asafiev's articles only as nationalistic pathos of a devoted patriot, which he certainly was. His text strongly ideologies of Soviet nation building in music, a pre-war Stalinist approach to non-Russian Soviet nations and their culture. The articles on folk music of Kazakhstan in 1936-1937 were implications of a 10-day festival of national art held in Moscow in 1936. The festival promoted the development of Soviet national policy following the first five-year plan of the Stalinist Cultural Revolution. Music was given a special place and it was noted in Moscow newspapers. Asafiev's article, Music of Kazakhstan, was published in his text. His text, I quote. Мелодика, скрывающая все обычно обывательские узкомузыкантские представления о восточной музыке, звучат мысли и думы, чувства и мироощущения веков и множество поколений, живших на великом историческом пути. Паттерн стал сосредоточением наших современных советских представлений о Востоке. Искусство такого художественного чувства народа, каким является варшавский народ, уже глубокая, основательная ценность. He also writes about the value of Yugoslavian music. Югославянская музыка задает исключительно мощными народно-интернациональными пластами может развиваться на основное и в сторону прекрасного возрождения мелочных принципов музицирования, древнейших культурных отсадков человечества и став по отношению к собакам Европы тем, чем была и остается русская музыка, не музыкальной провинцией, а высокой самостоятельной культурой, постигшей лучшее всечеловечески ценное достижение в Европе, etc. Cultures empowered, as the Tarasti states in his existential semiotics, do not present themselves in colonialist discourse as national, but rather as universal type. Whenever we signify something as meaningful for us, we create a sign which can function as a tool for exercising power. This happens especially when the given signification becomes a type or a legacy to something. Indeed, the colonialist view is present whenever we try to form universal definitions. Asakip's effort was to create a multi-ethnic mode for his theory of musical communication. I hope that Asakip's writings on folk music in the book on Narodnoi, Muzyke can be understood only if one reveals the overall philosophy of his views and the intellectual currents that he implemented to Soviet musical rhetoric. By analyzing the philosophical outputs of Asakip's monistic theory, I hope to reveal next another level of Asakip's rhetoric, what he aimed to provoke when he admired the sound of thoughts and ideas of Kazakh folk melody. I first quote philosopher and historian Andrei Valichki as he states, "The originality of Russian philosophy is not easy to define, whereas its dependence on Western European thought is obvious. Its striking originality can only be perceived when we examine it within the context of Russian intellectual history." End of quote. Asakip's philosophical background, which is based on modernism, and in particular his total allegiance to German idealist tradition, stood in conflict with official Soviet Marxism. He saw reality as continuously changing, a multifaceted philosophical position that he derived from Nikolai Lossky's interpretation of Henri Bergson's intuitive philosophy. Asakip was influenced by Bergson's concept, and that of modernists in general, of a living reality, subject to constant change, whereby a purely intellectual perception cannot attain the individuality of an object. He founded his premise of art on the continuity of evolution and on the intuitive contemplation of living reality. Following Hegel, Asakip's reasoning held that not just music, but apparently fine arts and the whole phenomenon of art reflect history of ideas in a very subtle manner within its peculiar international vocabulary that is summarized by a given epoch. According to Asakip, the masterpieces of genuine art were able to reflect one way or another universal ideas of humanity and the mysteries of eternal life. He applied Wilhelm Wöringer's interpretations of Theodor Lipse's theory of Einfühlung, empathy, and answered to Wöringer's call to write about the universal psychological basis of art history in Russian context. In the plan of musical sociology class that dates from the year 1927, he sets his thesis that equal his proto-semiotic theory of intonation that he formulated during high Stalinism. He states that music is a language and different musical traditions are different dialects. Yet within his organicist view of art led to the conclusion that it could be served by no idealized abstract scheme. There could be no proven receipt for beauty because the world was subject and to the constant motion, which meant that art as language of life was also under constant development. This development, as I have stated, needed to be natural, without any artificiality. Thus, socialist realism was, according to him, far from an artistic trend or a set of methodological principles of artistic creativity, the way 19th century realist aesthetics was perceived. It was rather a philosophical conviction that beauty lay in the truthful portrayal of reality, no matter what this may mean in different times, at one or another moment, in the existence of a world constantly in the flux. The moral connotation of art did not necessarily arise from its iconic relation to life, since art's reflection of life was not necessarily concrete. The living quality of art was rather some kind of energy inherent in life. The aim was to show the life of art art music of the future. We consider traditional folk music best material for it, since it manifests the everyday life of human being. Human life was written inside the melos of traditional folk song. Asak Yevgidna believe in ossified directives of how to compose correctly. One of the rare bits of concrete advice coming from Asakiev during the years when he taught at the Leningrad Conservatory was that the mere studying of musical scores would lead to academicism, which was incapable of grasping the living quality of art and achieving artistic experience whose nature was intuitive. He asserted that academicism leads to a stagnation which makes art incapable of functioning as a living historical document of the development in perception and understanding of life. This was his main thesis also when he highlighted folk music as the most genuine and true material that could be used in art music. Not by imitating it, but adopting its philosophical appearance. This is why he saw, for example, Sergei Rachmaninoff, a real folk artist. According to him, Rachmaninoff used no folk melodies, but was able to capture their melos and their living spirit in music. In musicological terms, the living spirit was manifested in the dynamic structures of music. Asak perceived his structures as energy, this structure as energy, based on the studies of energism at the beginning of the century, inspired by Viljanen. Asak's concept of symphonism, had nothing to do with the traditional concept of symphony. It was rather a designation of energy quality in music. Asak was clearly against pure progression schemes and studied dogmas, a position that was, however, also typical for creative Russian Marxism before it turned into the official Soviet philosophy. He stated that composers who merely follow ossified musical theoretical laws destroy the living and developing quality of art. Asakiev's statements could be interpreted as the assertion of art's relations to life, but they could also be interpreted as a formalist vision on art developing according to its own immanent project, for example, of art as such. His theory also strove to reach beyond individual tastes. Yet Soviet musical reality never functioned this way. The arbitrariness of art policy was forced not only by subjective tastes and goals of party officials, but also by competing artists. Asakiev's arguments appear contradictory and reactionary, mainly because he used so many traditional concepts that evoke anachronistic connotations in reader. The musical quality of his texts enabled his position also in the Stalinist Soviet Union. For example, following Nikolai Lossky's view, in contrast to Andrei Bergson's intuitive epistemology, Asakiev emphasized in his early writings the equal importance of both the intuitive and rationalist aspect in creative work. However, his emphasis on rational grew enormously as he moved towards the socialist realist aesthetics, because idealist mysticism became condemnable from the materialist point of view. Since it was not safe anymore to talk about one's idealist sources, it became expedient to refer to Russian classical national heroes such as Pushkin instead. The persistent nationalism in Russia and in the Soviet Union produced within its mechanism strong literary images and characters, those of our national heroes, equally favored by political leaders, cultural critics, especially those with a strong moral reason, such as Stasov and Tolstoy, and artists who would promote them and always consciously as a hierarchy of assured role models, everyone a true person. Such concepts and images functioned almost like ethical symbols of the coming good. Asakiev wrote, One has to possess, along with an artistic talent, the deep Pushkinian interpreting of intellect and emotion, and the Pushkinian culture. Instead of intuitive perception that he emphasized in his early writings, he used later on a simple concept of emotion. But the logic remains the same, and the meaning is harder to elucidate from.